Hello, good evening. My name's Mark Dunhill. I'm Dean of Academic Programs here at CSN, and it's my pleasure to welcome you and just to give a very brief introduction to what is one of a series of events run by our UAL chairs. And Isaac is our chair of global art. It's pretty appropriate in one way, certainly, in that Isaac seems to be all over the world most of the time producing his work, and I think he's just come back from Iceland this afternoon. But perhaps also more significantly, because he addresses global themes in many and various ways in much of his recent work. Isaac is an alumni of St. Martin's. He studied BA painting and fine art film, I think graduating in 1984,
yep,
something like that, and obviously has gone on to produce some extraordinary work, as is well known. So welcome to you, Isaac, and to Mark Nash and to Jean Fisher. Isaac will be just saying some introductory words as to how the evening is going to proceed, so I'm going to hand you over to him now. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mark, for your kind introduction, and also to introduce the series on global art. I couldn't think of a better sort of duo than Jean Fisher and Mark Nash. And in a sense, I could say that this continues some of the important work that was taking place at the Royal College of Art around creating the contemporary, where Mark and Jean and his colleagues, Claire, Carolyn, and audience, were champion, I would say, some of the important questions and interventions which have, I would say, to a certain extent, not really grasped their kind of total sort of hold in the art system and art world, which Jean will be talking to us about. And I think in my position of chair of global art, whatever that is, or whatever it is that one does, to my mind, it seems that it's very important to try to broach subjects which are kind of the kind of more difficult, thorny subjects, not just for contemporary art, but issues which I think are important in terms of the kind of interventions that they're making. And I think questions of these noble questions which Jean has been proffering us for over two decades, questions of indigeneity, I think, are really very centrally important to the developments and interventions that need to be made. And of course, my introduction to Jean comes really very much from being an art student and reading her texts. And I would say that my kind of personal introduction comes from Mark's position when he was at the Royal College, director of Creating the Contemporary, where I was able to actually, at first hand, have a very close relationship to these questions. So, I mean, I'm going to talk a little bit more later, but what we were going to do was Mark was going to introduce Jean, and then Jean was going to speak, but I've got
to introduce
Mark. You know, so Mark Nash.
Just two lines. That's it.
Just two lines. As an independent creator and writer, at the moment he is very much involved in working with Okrimwezo for Venice, upcoming Venice, on questions of capital, along with Torini. He sits here at the front, who works in our studio, and questions of capital are invariably linked to the project which I've been involved in, but also they're becoming very much part of the forefront of a curatorial project for Venice this year. And inevitably, these questions link, I think, very closely to questions of indigeneity, which Jean will be talking about. But Mark needs no introduction. He's organized many exhibitions. I'm thinking of his experiments with truth exhibition at a fabric workshop in 2004, and One Sixth of the Earth, Ecologies of the Image at ZKM, which were two exhibitions which I think were very much in the forefront of pushing questions which were laid down by Documenta 11 and continue to haunt the spectre of the art world, I would say, currently. So, Mark.
Thank you, Isaac. I don't actually have a prepared bio for Jean, so I'm going to improvise. As Isaac said, is my switch on? Yeah. As Isaac said, Jean and I have known each other for quite a long time, but we came together professionally when I joined the RCA directing the curating program there. And Jean was already doing one of the few courses, I think, in that whole institution dealing with questions of global art. And since that was my interest too, we developed it, and she developed the indigenous perspective that she's going to talk more about this evening. We also collaborated on a seminar in Banff, Canada, where we invited a number of indigenous North American and Canadian, well, American and Canadian artists and curators to discuss questions of curating indigenous work, because I was interested, and Jean to some extent also, in the parallels between the issues which Black British artists faced here and indigenous artists in the States. And maybe we can come back to those questions in our conversation. But as Isaac said, Jean is well known for an extensive body of writing, including the a collection of essays called Vampire in the Text, which she produced for Innova. She's also a contributor to Documenta 11, like myself, and did an important essay there. And was originally, after her a brief career as a biological scientist, I think I'm allowed to say this.
Zoologist, sorry.
Okay. Became a curator working particularly with Jimmy Durham in New York. But Jean has her own history as an independent curator before focusing more on teaching and academic research and curating. So what's going to happen this evening is Jean will make a presentation. Isaac will then respond to Jean's presentation with some images and thoughts of his own, and then I will ask some questions and attempt to chair and mediate with the audience. So thank you very much, and over to you, Jean. That's all right.
Thank you, Mark, and welcome, everybody. Thank you, Isaac. We're going to start with a DVD, so we can put that straight on.
I am.
Okay. That was, as you see, a multi-installation piece by a Canadian Cree artist called Kent Monkman, and it's called Dance to the Badash. But I'll speak more about Kent in a minute. What I'm presenting is an overview of what is now called indigeneity, although I don't recall us talking about it in quite those terms 30 years ago. But it arose from my engagement with artists who were grappling with the problems of colonialism. Now, I am going to focus on the Americas, but I'm showing these maps to show why so many writers, and that includes Deleuze, have made analogies between the situation of Native America and the situation of Palestinians. And to accompany that, just a little cartoon. There are something like 370 million indigenous peoples in the world, but who are they? And why, after centuries of marginalization, are they suddenly attracting interest from economics to environmentalism and art? So firstly, on the question of who, there's actually no official definition. The commonly accepted understanding of indigeneity is the UN Declaration of Rights of Indigenous Peoples. It was first drafted in 1985, but it was not adopted by the Human Rights Council until 2007. It is not legally binding. But the declaration states, indigenous communities, peoples, and nations are those having a historical continuity with pre-invasion and pre-colonial societies that developed on their territories. They are non-dominant sectors of society, determined to preserve, develop, and transmit to future generations their ancestral territories, their own cultural patterns, social institutions, and legal systems. In other words, the UN explicitly relates indigeneity to European colonial expansion and its ongoing legacies of rights violations and economic and socio-political marginality. Settler states have consistently refused to acknowledge indigenous rights as if the people didn't exist. In 2007, the US, Canada, New Zealand, and Australia voted against this UN declaration, although in 2010 they agreed an informal, non-binding vote. Israel did not attend the vote at all. In a renewed vote following last September's UN World Conference on Indigenous Peoples, Canada again rejected the declaration. What the political status of Indigenous Americans is fairly contradictory. Are they citizens of the state? In fact, some have in the past refused to travel on US passports. Or are they citizens of sovereign nations, native nations? And if they are the latter, then they belong to stateless nations. But paradoxically, this ambiguous existence may indeed have been the key to their cultural survival. The statement at the 2013 UN World Conference on Indigenous Peoples noted, for centuries, we indigenous peoples have faced and continue to face colonization of our lands, territories, resources, air, ice, oceans and waters, mountains and forests. This has resulted in patterns of domination, exploitation, and subjugation of our peoples. Such patterns can be traced to claims of discovery and conquest, papal bulls, royal charters, manifest destiny, and other erroneous and legally invalid doctrines. So first point I want to draw your attention to is the one of misrepresentation. Because the power claimed by these erroneous doctrines has long been supported by the misrepresentation of indigenous peoples. Dehumanization justified dispossession, often under the excuse of Christianization. And misrepresentation begins with reports by the first European invaders who imagined the Americas were populated by basically two classes of quasi-humans. First, the Plinian or monstrous races, so called by antiquity, and they existed beyond the boundaries of the then known world. They are people with aberrant bodily forms or dietary habits, including the anthropophagi, otherwise known as cannibals. And the second is the wild family, the wild man. And this dates from the Mesopotamian epic of Gilgamesh and Enkidu. And this creature existed in forests outside the city walls. It represented the binary nature culture. And he morphed later into characters like the noble savage. In other words, pre-existing European myths and fantasies were imposed on indigenous Americans from the outset, and these are inseparable from colonial rhetoric. And so it continued. Through Enlightenment debates on the savage versus the romantic noble savage or natural man, which was not about the native, but a critique of European degeneracy, and thence to the perversion of Darwinism that categorized people as immature, civilized, or degenerate, leading to racist eugenics, in which people deemed genetically inferior were to be exterminated. So here's just a few familiar examples. A savage of the 19th century, reproduced in Dances with Wolves, Care of the Pawnee. A Noble Savage by George Catlin in the 19th century, reproduced in Dances with Wolves and represented by the Lakota Sioux. And then, of course, this doesn't need any comment, does it? Avatar. My next point involves land dispossession and cultural destruction. Myth, not reality, is the driving force that justifies genocide and ethnic cleansing. It satisfies settler greed for land, but also for an identity that will enable him to recreate himself in this foreign land. So here's an interesting example, I hope. The English pilgrims landed on the coast of Wampanoag territory, now Massachusetts, in 1620. By the 1630s, the Puritans were claiming the land as their own God-given promised land. They said, this new Canaan was a wilderness that had to be freed of strangers, even if each mile is a marsh of blood. So the point is this, for these colonizers, the world, past and present, was a text to be interpreted through the biblical revealed word of God. Thus, the Puritans discovered America, not as an inhabited geography, but through scripture. As one historian remarks, the Puritan documents show the astonishing capacity of myth, not only to obscure, but to invent reality. European Zionism, both Christian and Jewish, makes identical biblical claims of ownership to Palestine. So, a few quotes. Jimmy Durham, speaking of American Indian history. Is it really possible to take over someone's house, murder most of the family, lock the remaining victims in the closet, and then pretend that it is your own little house on the prairie in the suburbs. Moshe Dayan in 1969. Jewish villages were built in the place of Arab villages. You do not even know the names of these Arab villages, and I do not blame you, because these geography books no longer exist. Not only do the books not exist, the Arab villages are not there either. There is not one place built in this country that did not have a former Arab population. Golda Meir, the same year, infamously says, "It was not as if there was a Palestinian people in Palestine and we came and threw them out and took their country away. They did not exist." And Jimmy, once more. The master narrative of the US proclaims that there were no Indians in the country, simply wilderness. Then that the Indians were savages in need of the US. Then that the Indians all died, unfortunately. Then that the Indians today are A, basically happy with the situation, and B, not the real Indians. Then, most importantly, that this is the complete story. Nothing contrary can be heard. James is making two points, I think, here, and that's his own mugshots. That the so-called Indian was a European construction, and that the indigenous peoples have pluralized identities and multiple subject positions like anyone else. And that, as you see, is reflected too in the Kent Monkman's work. With the Indians now disappeared, their names and images are appropriated to the fantasies of commercial advertising and sports teams. By the 1980s, however, decolonizing representation had become a major critical strategy of conceptually oriented indigenous artists. So this is Edgar Heath-Byrd's on this theme. And this one too, about Cleveland Indians mascot. And a more recent cartoon about the same theme. And here's James Luna again with Artifact Piece, a performance where he's playing with a disappeared Indian by placing himself in a museum vitrine. Like Durham's installation on loan from the Museum of the American Indian, which was about 2 years before this, it challenges White's views of Indians as historical rather than contemporary peoples. And here's just one part that was included in on loan from the Museum of the American Indian. It's called Indian Family. I'm sorry, it's a really poor slide taken from an old 35mm slide. Sorry, I couldn't get it better than this. Anyway, this is on the left, real Indian blood, and then real Indian's family, where, of course, you see just ordinary looking folks dressed in an ordinary way. So now I'll come to the question of why indigeneity should have become a focus of attention. It connects to several interrelated post-humanist discourses which are currently under discussion: biopolitics or biopower, and rights of nature or eco-sustainability. So firstly, a word on biopolitics or biopower. This is the intersection or intervention of state politics with biological and social processes. In other words, it's an apparatus that controls the physical body and its functions, and the social body and its movements. Foucault raised this issue way back in 76 in a lecture series called Society Must Be Defended. Now, he was speaking about Europe, but indigenous peoples have been subjected to this form of total control for centuries. So we have a few examples. During the 18th century Indian Wars, an epidemic of smallpox decimated Indian populations because the British reputedly distributed infected blankets. From the 1890s, laws against Indians included removal to reservations governed by state agents, the Bureau of Indian Affairs, and prohibition of customs and languages. During the 1960s and 70s, 25 to 50% of American women were involuntarily sterilized. And by the way, Israel has recently admitted that it gave birth control injections to black Ethiopian Jewish women on the pretext of inoculations. The US government assumes the right to determine Indian identity on the basis of blood quantum, 1/4 minimum usually, and registration as a member of the federally approved tribe under the Dawes Allotments Act and Rolls of the 1890s. To get a certificate, you have to be enrolled and produce a full genealogy with legal documents. Something like that. In 1990, on the pretext of safeguarding the Indian arts market from Asian knockoffs, the US Congress sought to limit Indian identity by the Indian Arts and Crafts Act, Public Law 101. This stated that no artist could publicly call him or herself Indian unless they were formally registered on the Dawes Rolls. Penalty, $250,000 or 5 years in jail. Jimmy Durham fell foul of this, and an exhibition in California was cancelled. Why? In the 1920s, his Cherokee clan had refused to sign up to the Dawes Rolls. So according to US law, he was not an Indian. In 1993, he chose exile in Europe. But one little note of caution, we should avoid essentializing indigenous identities. For example, it was common practice for native societies to adopt and integrate non-Indians. And Cynthia Parker is one famous example from what's known as the captivity narratives. As you see, captured by the Comanche 89, that should be 1836, sorry. She was married happily with children, recaptured by Texas Rangers 27 years later. She did not reintegrate. And one of her sons, Quanah Parker, became a very famous Comanche leader. Anyway, as I say here, the Searchers was based on her story. Another example, Cherokee freedmen. The Cherokee possessed African slaves, but the tribe outlawed slavery in 1863 when Africans became citizens of the Cherokee Nation as so-called Cherokee freedmen. But in the early 1980s, the Cherokee Nation amended citizenship rules to include only those Cherokee by blood, now excluding some 25,000 black Cherokee descendants, including mixed race. In 2006, the Cherokee Supreme Court ruled this unconstitutional, but the ruling was contested. Unfortunately, the controversy continues. But what this rather sad story illustrates is that the US government introduced racist classifications into a people for whom this had never been an issue. Another example is the traditional integration of transsexual and transgender differences. Tribes recognized individuals as sometimes third or even fourth genders, and they were called two spirits. They often had revered status, but as with racism, the pressures of white prejudice had a negative effect on native cultures, and the two spirits suffered discrimination. You'll see that Kent Monkman's DVD is called After the Catlin Dance to the Badash. And here he is, as Mischief Eagle Testicle, the two-spirit traditional figure he takes as his alter ego. So one of his strategies is to satirize representations of Indians and to present contemporary Indian identities as complex syntheses of multiple influences. And I don't know if you noticed in that excerpt from his installation, aside from refrains from the Indian flute and singing, you could catch parts of Stravinsky's Rites of Spring. So to illustrate how there's a synthesis of cultures going on here, that it's much more ambiguous and contradictory these days. Next point to talk about is rights of nature and eco-sustainability. Indigenous Americans say, we belong to the land does not belong to us, which is the antithesis of the European idea of land as exploitable property. The heroic master narratives of westward expansion and manifest destiny are myths that are connected to the romantic sublime aesthetic insofar as it treats landscape as an object for possession by the colonizing gaze. So an example of the American sublime is this Bierstadt painting, which is something else that Kent satirizes, artist and model here. As you see, the figure is also a spoof on San Sebastian. So he does numerous reversals and plays games. On a more sober note, the Canadian Métis artist Edward Poitras, what he did here, he cut two strips of grass and exchanged one from the prairie, one from a suburban lawn. And he says that the lawn turf died when it was in the prairie. 80% of the world's biodiversity is in territories occupied by indigenous peoples, now threatened by agribusinesses and extractive corporations. According to a 2008 report by the World Bank entitled, The Role of Indigenous Peoples in Biodiversity Conservation, the Natural but Often Forgotten Partners, they say, the perception has been that biodiversity conservation is sometimes pursued without regard to the rights and social realities of indigenous peoples, who have, in many cases, been important stewards of that biodiversity for millennia. Agribusiness and big pharma have already exploited indigenous knowledge without recompense, I might add, and have sought to patent genomes of plants that indigenous peoples developed over millennia. And this new war concerns biopiracy and biocolonialism. This slide talking about one problem, which is the wild rice, but there are many others. The Eurocentric stereotype of pre-conquest cultures as primitive and static was an arrogant and, I might say, misogynist denial of the truth. The philosophical and scientific contribution of Indigenous Americans to world knowledge is that environmental, social, and individual well-being depends on understanding their interrelatedness. For this reason, the Rights of Nature movement, first published in 1989 by white activists, has since sought alliance with indigenous peoples. In Latin America, buen vivir, good living, a concept derived from indigenous peoples in which nature is given legal rights, was adopted by the Ecuador Constitution in 2008. Although not without contradictions, since Ecuador still supports extractive industries. The notable contribution of Indigenous Americans is the development of food staples, and to name a few, potatoes, tomatoes, cocoa, and the three sisters, maize, beans, and squash, plus medicines and analgesics like aspirin, tobacco, coca, curare, and quinine. And the three sisters have revered status. They're traditionally grown together in mounds in a technique known as co-cropping. And this diagram illustrates the mutual benefit of what each contributes to the other and, in fact, to the earth itself. In other words, with this co-cropping method of the three sisters, there is no soil depletion, no artificial fertilizers, no toxic pesticides and herbicides, no water wastage, no hard labor, and no shareholder profits. The three sisters were developed in Mesoamerica, but they are staples in the north as well. And this tells us that despite not having a wagon wheel, pre-conquest peoples traded widely in goods, medicinal herbs, cultural innovations, and ideas. The Canadian First Nations activist group, Idle No More, and the Indigenous Environmental Network have attracted widespread environmentalist support across Canada and the US. These Indigenous social movements focus on resistance to the destruction of Indigenous land and water security by mining corporations. And just to show you what this means, an ongoing conflict is with the extraction of fracking and new proposed pipelines from the Athabasca tar sands, which have jeopardized cultural heritage, ecosystems, and health. Extraction from tar sands is water intensive and leaves toxic tailings that seep into rivers and aquifers. You saw the caption in the previous one, didn't you? I hope. Subhankar Banerjee, an Asian Indian artist who's worked in the Arctic region for many years, as a photographer. There's a famous photograph of a polar bear walking across the ice in side view. If you know that, it was one of his photographs, but he's never been credited. Anyway, this is the story here. While tracking caribou migrations in Alaska, he discovered tracks of illegal mining exploration vehicles. I don't know if you can see the caribou tracks. They're the tiny wiggly ones, going like this. And you can tell which of the motorized vehicles. These were illegal. The other point is that the Arctic people follow the caribou, so even this ecosystem has human populations. In any case, you know that the violation of fragile ecosystems by extractive corporations is not restricted to this area. It is a global scandal. So I now want to come to dissidents and resistance. For the indigenous, way of life, history, and language itself all derive from the relationship to the land. And if this is lost or mutilated, then the social body undergoes a crisis of identity. The cultural trauma suffered by survivors takes several generations to work through. It was therefore not until the 1960s and 70s with the civil rights movement that Indigenous Americans sought self-determination through the American Indian Movement, AIM. They were met with counterinsurgency, state violence, assassination, and imprisonment. And most famously, following the military standoff between AIM activists, state troopers, and the FBI at Wounded Knee on the Pine Ridge Reservation in 1973. Actually, the site of a massacre of Lakota Sioux by the 7th Cavalry in 1890. Since then, however, indigenous activism has taken less militant forms, amongst which one might describe a refusal to comply, rather like Bartleby's "I prefer not to." That is, a refusal to cooperate except on their own terms, and a refusal also to function as anthropological informers. So they've become very circumspect about revealing themselves, and this is what Jolene Rickard's photography was about. And a series called Street Chiefs by Richard Ray Whitman. So the grassroots activists, like Idle No More, represent a new front of indigenous collective action. And this is paralleled by scholarly development, which has been increasingly grounded in synthesizing indigenous knowledge with Western critical practice. They argue that white-led university Indian studies faculties become another form of neocolonialism because they are based in Eurocentric methodologies. Thus, in terms of, for example, subjective fragmentation, one can say that the indigenous experienced postmodernism avant la lettre, and post-colonial theories' origin in exile and diaspora doesn't quite fit ongoing decolonization struggles. The Anishinaabe writer Gerald Visenor refers to this post-Indian recovery as survivance, survival and resistance. Quote, a renunciation of dominance, tragedy and victimry. Survivance rarely changes the external politics with the state, but it produces a new internal narrative that raises dignity, self-empowerment, and agency. So in art, this is reflected in various ways. For example, the reclamation of repressed histories, satirical critiques of pop and consumer culture, and commentaries on environmental issues. So here's Edgar, when he was invited to the Venice Biennale, he made a series of signage panels which referred to Buffalo Bill's Traveling Wild West show in the late 1800s. I believe some Indian participants died and they were buried there, but I think their bodies were eventually taken back to the US. Anyway, that's a story I can't quite remember. James Luna again. Never short of satirical methods. Brian Jungen, Canadian. with Northwest-style totem poles made of sports equipment. And Brian, again, with his piece called Shapeshifter. And note, the shapeshifter is a term given to the native trickster figure. And it's not only to do with his ability to change form, which happens in the narrative sometimes, but he also, most importantly, is a figure that reshapes the world itself. And Minerva Cuevas from Mexico, Del Monte murder. So this is one of several similar installations she made around this issue of exploitation of land and resources, specifically by the Del Monte agribusiness. So she made all these labels for cans and other things, and in this particular installation, the mural, where she modifies the name of the product by reference to Mont, Guatemala's president, who was responsible for murdering the indigenous Ixil people. That's just one of many such works she does. In some, well, not quite some, I've still got a page to go, there has been an immense conceptual gulf between Eurocentric and indigenous American worldviews. Note Cherokee philosopher Brian Yazzie Burkhart's riposte to Descartes, "We think, therefore I am." Or the late Lakota Sioux lawyer Vine Deloria Jr., who noted that in 19th century judicial proceedings, Indian oral testimonies were discounted since only written accounts by whites were admissible in court as truth. But for native peoples, oral transmission spoke the tribal archive and therefore nothing but the truth. Or we can think of cosmology. Western science is built on Newtonian physics and Cartesianism, which assume an objective view of a world regarded as measurable and hierarchical. In other words, a privileged point of view complicit with the racist constructs of imperialism. Indigenous knowledge was dismissed as primitive and inconsequential. However, as the Tewa Pueblo scholar Gregory Cahete points out, Native American science actually correlates with quantum mechanics, popularly known as chaos theory or the butterfly effect. Here, the observer is an active agent in any observation. Chaos and creativity dynamically coexist. Everything is process, and processes are irreducibly relational and interdependent. And to an extent, that is what Fernando Paloma Rodriguez is doing in this piece called Our Lady Butterfly. The butterfly in question is the monarch. So as you go close to these little things, the butterflies start flapping their wings. And as I say here, in some versions, he set it up so that you set off one and it'll start the Mexican wave. So the butterflies, as you see, are cut from beer cans and soda cans. I've lost my place. So what else is this about, apart from the butterfly effect? Well, the monarch migrates between Canada and Mexico. Therefore, the work on one level refers to the intercontinental unity of indigenous peoples. Especially, Fernando will talk about the sign language, which was the means of communication across, diverse tribal groups. From an environmental perspective, the work also speaks of to the decline of the monarch and its reanimation as image, because you will often find consumer products in Mexico patterned with the monarch image. However, in the US, GM crops are bred to be resistant to herbicides. Spraying herbicides devastates the surrounding ecology, and this has had a catastrophic effect on the milkweed plant, which is crucial to the life cycle of the butterfly. So there you have it. Fernando is part of a local Nahua NGO southeast of Mexico City in an area called Milpalta. But inspired by the Zapatista social movement in Chiapas, southern Mexico, the Zapatistas initially engaged in armed resistance and internet activism against the Mexican government's 1994 North American Free Trade Agreement with the US and Canada. They foresaw that this would devastate local farmers and land security. Their aim was not anti-state revolution, but social justice based in Mayan beliefs and resistance to encroachment on their communal lands by government and corporations. As Subcomandante Marcos said, "We didn't go to war to kill or be killed. We went to war in order to be heard." So that's it. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oops, I'll set you up. You're going?
Yeah. I'll do an exchange.
Yeah. So now Isaac's going to make some remarks about his engagement with the topic of Jean's talk, and then we'll open it up for some questions and conversation. Thank you again, Jean, for a very eloquent and elaborate view of the topic.
Thank you so much, Jean, for your fantastic and critical talk. And I think one of the things that, to my mind, that Jean does is to make us face, I think, some very important questions, which, as I think Jean has pointed out, are kind of repressed in the kind of global lingua franca of the art world as it coexists. I mean, I think there's a way in which part of Jean's talk undertitled in relationship to art systems is precisely the way in which sort of these repressions but interventions that have been made by indigenous artists are very important and have this historical lineage to questions which are kind of uncomfortable, I think, in terms of the questions that they pose for different audiences. And I think this uncomfortableness is very important in terms of us not trying to make this sort of smooth transition into debates around sort of global art. But of course, you know, as was rightly said in the beginning, I am someone who travels and transverses into different spaces. And in a sense, one of the reasons why I wanted Jean Mark to sort of, in a sense, open the series was connected to a work which I made with the Tuhoi in New Zealand, who are the Maori tribe, who are, in fact, one of the most political groups working in New Zealand. And the True South series originated from this collaboration with them. And one of the things for me which was very important was precisely this way of trying to reframe my kind of US-centric viewing of art school training of the way in which I was viewing landscape. And it was really by this constant sort of, in a way, well, you could call it a kind of re-indoctrinating discourse, which was quite persistent in terms of making me kind of view this space as a kind of space that had been completely recolonialized in terms of forestry, in terms of its landscape, in terms of its culture, and this insistency around the crown, which was always being sort of spoken of. And it was very, very insistent. And I spoke about the relationship to my role as an artist. So they were interested in my work, but of course they were very much interested in me really trying to change my point of view in terms of the kinds of works that I was making. And one of the interesting things which developed in this collaboration was really the whole point of being forced by Onion, who this portrait is here, of a work that would be distributed to everybody that wasn't editioned, and that somehow the image and my knowledge of the image, or how I had learnt about the image, was being completely deconstructed in terms of an image that belonged not to a person as such, but to everybody. And this question of the image of the land, and this questioning of the actual way in which one has, as it were, this kind of Eurocentric training in relationship to both portraiture and landscape, was very much the beginning of this conversation around the contaminated sublime that I was interested in. And I think it's no accident to think about the kind of resistance which Jean was pointing out to, that many sort of countries make in terms of repudiating UN treaty around indigenous rights, and that persistent sort of reframing and sort of, complete rejection of those perspectives. And in an about way, I guess, it was through making this work that I began thinking about these questions. So, I just wanted to share kind of these images with you, and they're kind of a sort of conversation, really, that has developed in relationship to thinking about these questions and pushing these questions more to the forefront, but in a way that I think needs a certain re-examination and re-articulation. So thank you, Jean.
Oh, thank you, Isaac.
Thank you, Isaac. Maybe come back to Isaac's work as part of our more general discussion, but I thought we might start with a reflection maybe on this notion of global art more generally, and come back to your focus presentation. That's because I switched to mute.
Is that better? You can hear me now. Okay, I thought we should come back to start with a discussion of this notion of global art, and just to introduce a term I'm sure you're familiar with, but this opposition which writers like, theorists like Gayatri Spivak introduced, called the planetary as opposed to the global. And in her formulation, the global is, in a way, an image of the world as it was seen from space, the sphere traversed by the trajectory of airline routes and so on. It's something that's easily grasped conceptually. And the planetary is a much more grounded, located, experienced mode of living in the world. And so in some writers, Paul Gilroy is another one, they try where they can to introduce that dialectic between those two terms. They reframe the notion of the global more in terms of international capital and the effect of international capital, and the planetary can also be then a site for individual or group resistance to that. And I just thought, well, Jean's presentation and in a sense Isaac's comments through his work as well were very good illustrations of that concept, because the presentation on the way indigeneity has been constructed on the one hand here in the West, but on the other hand how it's lived and the contribution that different indigenous peoples have made really exemplify this notion of a planetary point of view. I mean, wouldn't you think, Jane, that's...
yes, they, of course, I mean, one of the stereotypes that is said, they say, is their attachment to the idea of the four corners of the world, which is an all-inclusive notion. Mm. But it's also grounded. It's a lived environment. Mm. So when you're talking about the global, I was just then had a flash of some medieval images of the globe. And so, yes, well, it all depends on your perspective, because in those days, you know, like Europe would place Jerusalem at the center, and you know, it would all fade off towards the edges. They didn't know what was out there, except Plinian races. I'm not quite sure how I understand the planetary. That looks like going out into space. So what exactly do they mean by that?
Well, I think in a way it's part of a debate which actually David Harvey was involved in, who participated in Isaac's Capital project, when as part of that project, that discussion they had at the Hayward a couple of years ago, he talks about the fact that nature has not been fully capitalized, not been fully financialized. He, although he's a Marxist critic, he still sees the strength of and the potential that capital has, a lot more work that it can do in exactly the kinds of processes you're talking about, the extractive industries, for example.
Or destructive industries.
Destructive, extractive industries, the use of genetically modified foods and so on, that one has to abandon this idea that nature is somehow going to protect itself against these forces. So I think a number of thinkers like that were trying to come up with a different term, that's all. I think one can still use the term global, but you have to put it into quotation marks, because you also have the term global used, shall we say, for Hong Kong Shanghai Banking Corporation is a global brand or whatever, to pick one such entity that's in our minds right now. I wanted just to maybe move to one of the key points that you are making about the relationship to land, however, because the points that you're making and that Isaac's making can be reiterated across the world in terms of the situation of other indigenous peoples, some of whom, like the Australian Aboriginal peoples, have a very close relationship to contemporary art too. And there were two points. One, because it occurred to me as we were talking, the presence of indigenous artists in the international art world, which is, to my mind, scandalously, they're really ignored. Brian Jungen was one of two indigenous artists, I think, in the last documentary. Australian one, Brian Jungen. And then Carolyn Christoph had, to my mind, the audacity to place a work by Emily Carr at the other end of the room from, as it were, in quotes, a genuine indigenous artists. But whatever the case, that the work that Jean has been showing here and other kinds of art practices do not really get the attention that they should deserve, especially given the critical force of some of the work. But then I was also reminded by reading about the situation in Australia, where the issue of water rights and land rights is still as important, as critical as it is in America today. And the difficulty in having these conversations is, of course, each situation is quite specific and it takes place within a specific legal framework. But I think the general strategy of kind of, as you say, settler capitalist countries is entities is a kind of divide and rule strategy. So in Australia, although there was a big move to create Aboriginal indigenous land rights, the rights to water were separated from that, so that actually indigenous people, Aboriginal people, do not have automatic water titles, so they can inherit as much desert as they like. But if, whereas the mining corporations, they can extract water without having to get planning permission, so to speak. So there are these different relationships in different countries where indigenous people are still put on the defensive. So what you're talking about the continuing kind of colonial project, genocidal colonial project, you could say it's still existing, even though nobody would like to admit to that.
In fact, almost everywhere you look where there's an indigenous struggle, you will find water as a problem. And in fact, it was where I started with Jimmy, in a way, because I had this notion when I was employed at SUNY Old Westbury, where I had to curate two exhibitions, that one of the exhibitions I would like to do would be contemporary Native American art. And I'd seen some in marginal galleries in New York, one of which was Joe Overstreet's gallery and down in the Lower East Side.
Yeah.
And then American Indian, the American Indian Community House Gallery. My boss at SUNY was Luis Kamnitz, the Uruguayan artist. And I went to him and I said, look, I'd like to do this show. There's no way I could do it on my own. That would not be correct. But I wouldn't mind trying to find a Native American artist, because wouldn't be any curators, but artists, to co-curate with me. He happened to be a big friend of Jimmy Durham. I'm getting to the point of this story, don't worry. So I then go and contact Jimmy Durham, and I say, Mr. Durham, I actually did say Mr. Durham, I have this idea and wondered if you would like to help out with it, co-curate this exhibition. He said, I'll do that if you help me on a problem I have. And it was the very last thing he did for the American Indian movement. It was the fact that the women of all red nations were lobbying Congress over water rights, because the Corps of Engineers had been damming the Missouri River. Mining corporations were like poisoning the earth, and there was no potable water. So I helped him out with the water rights problem. Unfortunately, they lost their case. But from that point on, we thought, okay, well, if you can't do it through a political legal matter, let us foreground some issues by way of what we can access, which was the art world. So that's how that sort of came about.
And then you continued to work for some time with Jimmy on a number of projects.
Well, yes, then there was... Well, the thing is, you see, I had access to Art Forum. I had various lines of access, right? And I said, we can capitalize on these. So I had access to Art Forum. I had access to a couple of galleries. And I had access to the Whitney program, student Whitney program. So it was like various ways of visibility that, you know, like we could get Indian speakers in to make interventions. But, you know, no one else was there doing anything. No.
And my impression is that not many people are doing this today, in fact. Which was why, one of the reasons why, as Isaac said at the beginning, he wanted to start this series of talks with this particular focus, because it does have this connection to the broader narratives of the post-colonial. And I think we do need reminding that in many parts of the world, there is still a colonial presence. And I think you're, in a way, very provocative, but nevertheless very insightful first slide, which links situation in Palestine with the situation of the American Indians is entirely opposite, because people don't want to talk about the situation in Palestine as a colonial project,
they won't.
Which it very evidently is.
But to say something about the relationship of contemporary indigenous artists, and I'll have to stick with the Americas for a minute, in relation to, like, the arts system, there can be many contradictions. And you remember that in that Banff event we did, Jolene Rickard and the curator guy, I can't remember his name, but they were the US contingent rather than the Canadian contingent, and they were pretty hard-assed about, well, I think we're going to do, you know, shows for ourselves. So there's this point of view where native peoples will maybe only do something for their own communities. And there's another set that will say, yes, we will go out and try and intervene in you know, global art.
Yeah. I mean, this was...
That was really difficult, though, as you say. And if you look at major shows, I mean, you've named a few, where you do find indigenous artists, and you will recognize this from the 80s, it is where a show is privileging environmental issues in one way or another. So they are locked into the environmental discourse. Jimmy Durham is almost the only one who is not locked into that discourse, right? So the shows recently, I mean, there was the Sydney Biennale, the one before the last one, called All Our Relations, which was deliberately named after a phrase that Native Americans often use. And that had Native artists, and there was a show called Yes, Naturally in Rotterdam a couple of years ago, and that was an environmentalist-oriented show, and that had Native artists in it. And then there was the Nottingham Contemporary, Rights of Nature, where, yes, there's Fernando. and there's Minerva, and a lot of mention of indigeneity, but not that many indigenous artists.
And of course, that also comes back to the fact that we're speaking about an issue which, although we are very passionately concerned about it, we are not representatives. We are, in a sense, speaking about a set of issues. We are, in a way, taking it upon ourselves not necessarily to speak for Native American artists, but to be somehow their advocates or tribunes in particular conversations. I'll just make one more remark, just following up Jean's one about this seminar that we organized in Banff in Canada, because it also focused on the different political histories of the Native American, the First Nations people in Canada and in the United States. Mm. And the more, I think, in general, it's a bit of a generalization, but the more radical groupings were those in the United States who felt that they had been totally dispossessed, which they had been, whereas in Canada, various nations had a treaty with the Crown, and they were a little bit more accepted by the then Canadian government. Now, as you say, the Canadian government is much less accommodating. Mm. But, for example, Gerard McMaster, who was the curator of that Sydney Biennial, said to me that, well, when I come to London, I could go and have tea with the Queen, because I'm not a Canadian citizen, I'm a member of, I think, the Cree, I'm not quite sure which tribe he was, but...
A stateless nation.
Sorry?
A stateless nation.
A stateless nation. So there were different traditions within those communities. Mm. But I think maybe we should put the lights up and then invite some questions to Jean or to Isaac, unless Isaac wants to ask something, a question to Jean to kick off.
Well, it's just this question of the Crown, since you've just mentioned that with Canada. I mean, did you see that thing reflected in New Zealand?
Oh, very much so. I mean, I think in a way the relationship to the Crown is really very interesting, because I think about that, and I think about that in relationship to discourses around post-coloniality, and I think there's not one friend of mine who is a kind of successful black artist or creator that hasn't accepted an MBE or an OBE. And, you know, so this question of the Crown and how it's signifying is really interesting. On the one hand, you'll have someone like Gerard who would talk about having this access to the Queen, and the Maori group will then, well, they insistently kept referring to the Crown. It was like a sort of empire thing. Mm. It was like saying, you know, these people are here, but, you know, they're here constituted through this sovereignty, which is a kind of forced sovereignty. At the same time, they recognized the power of the Crown. It was something that just kept being referred to the whole time. Mm. And then it is a sort of question I've had for my colleagues about this relationship to this sort of acceptance of this position. And absolutely everybody has accepted it, you know. You know, so there's this signifying thing of the Crown here, which haunts, I think, both the indigenous, from a different critical perspective, I would say, and the kind of post-colonial. And for me, it's really interesting, this sort of iconic presence, you know, that the Crown has in terms of its signification. And so I guess that's one question I have in relationship to that. But also, there's also the question of behalfism, you know, which, you know, I think perhaps people who are indigenous could point a finger to us all. Obviously, because we are not indigenous in this sense, and that kind of ambiguous role, because the role of the art critic and the curator has this sort of partnership or collaboration in terms of trying to create that space, to create that memory. And I think in your presentation, for me, what's important about that is to hold on to this as a sort of space for both meditation and thinking about these difficult questions, which is a sort of unfinished conversation. But I think in relationship to the artist, then, it's very interesting, that sort of position. Because one of the things when I was making that work was that I was referred to quite often in a joking manner about being dark, you know, or being black, you know. There were several jokes that were made. I mean, I took it on the chin, but
From the Tuhoi,
yeah. And at the same time, there was this certain militancy that the Tuhoi had, you know. So, kind of, you know, I think, you know, it's always a kind of ambivalence. But I think it's the ambivalence that produces this sort of interesting kind of aspect, both in the kind of global sphere or the international sphere, and the kind of domestic and local sphere. And so, and then how we're placed within that. But I think this is probably the time where we could open it out if there are any questions.
So,
thank you for being so patient with us.
Yes, we didn't mention it at the beginning, but actually you are all on film. The university is making a film for distribution within the university. So you want to ask a question, if you could just say your name, I think that would be helpful. Just raise your hand and then we'll and ask whatever questions you would like to ask. There's some microphones going around. I can see Zegem's going to push off.
Very briefly, I think what you started to talk about, the distinction between planetary and globalization itself is very interesting. But obviously, it needs another time to talk about it more properly, but I just want to mention two things. First, about the notion of planetary was coined by Alexander von Humboldt, actually at the very height of colonialism. You know, 19th century, of course, it was his contribution to the notion of universal that was used by Hegel at this time. And planetary was a little bit trying to bring a sort of physical aspect of this notion of universality, because he is considered as founder of many, including geography, which are mineralogy, other, you know, physical sciences. He was traveling a lot. So I think it's very interesting because very much connected to colonialization and universalism. And then second thing, globalization, of course, people like Arjun Appadurai, if you take modernity at large, actually the title Modernity at Large is a sort of globalization that is expanded to the, but he also has a very interesting theory of scapes, yeah? So actually that's what I wanted to say, because it's very intriguing. I think I haven't, apart from Marie-Louis Pratt, who wrote a book about contact zones, Imperial Eyes is called. I haven't came back, and now you mentioned, it's very interesting for me. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I think the, I mean, thinking about it a bit more, I wish I knew more about this. I've forgotten all my science from way back. But the idea that Native American way of thinking has more relation to quantum mechanics suggests a kind of, does, I don't know about planetary, but certainly a cosmological dimension that is inclusive of everything, you know. But it is important for them, it's seen as a complete mobility, this process, and that things aren't static. I suppose when I think of globalization, I think of some fixed kind of entities. I don't, and planetary is better. Planets move, don't they?
I do, but I think you could the chair of planetary art. I don't know. It doesn't quite work for some reason, but I think. Yeah, I think, but it's very interesting about this question of land, and I think you're right, there's a kind of trope, curatorially, perhaps, in the way in which sort of indigenous artists are being framed, and it's convenient in a curatorial strategy to point this kind of political question, but there's something around capital, well, because I'm very interested in that as a subject at the moment, that comes back to haunt the way in which sort of land is being financialized in a particular manner. And when I think about capital and how it reduplicates itself in a kind of digital sense, there's still this question of indigeneity, which I think is going to, in a way, haunt the kind of the space of land rights and the role that artists maybe can play, and that sort of curatorial interest that will link, or you know, there's one form of digging that's taking place, but there's this other kind of digging, I think, that will come about in relationship to those questions that will come back to be with us very much, I think, in the future as ice is disappearing. I mean, I just got back from Iceland and, you know, glaciers melting and the possibility for the capital financialization of all those spaces.
Was it you who said to me that the more the US melts, the more it gets opened up to extractive corporates?
Absolutely, and Alaska and Greenland and, you know, all of these spaces where there's a kind of, you know, quite a high kind of velocity of interest in those spaces. China has brought up parts of Greenland and there's, you know, Africa. It's all about that idea of raw materials and that substantiates the capitalist kind of production processes. I think that, in a sense it's obvious, but it feels that...
It's also a little bit depressing. I mean, it's a very serious, disturbing situation across the whole of the world, in fact. I wanted to ask Jean if you knew any more about the UN Declaration as to whether it has actually any force or any teeth, or whether any indigenous activists have been able to make use of this, or whether it's more like a kind of cosmetic attempt to keep people quiet while business as usual goes on.
Mm. Well, as I said, it's not legally binding.
Mm.
So I would say, yes, it is more of a cosmetic thing. And as I said also, those settler countries that are key to this dragged their feet about signing up. Israel is still not. Canada's reneged because they're like hot to trot on the Athabasca tar sands and they want to get as much extraction from there as possible. Apart from the fact that the UN hasn't got many teeth anyway, you know, overall, then I don't think I've heard of anything in which any indigenous people have been able to tap into that declaration. I think it's more like many of these declarations, they're drawn up by predominantly white folk. Although I will say that it was talked about and started to be framed in 1985, but prior to that, there had been some preliminary work done. And Jimmy Durham was involved in that because he was part of the International Indian Treaty Council and representative at the UN on that Treaty Council. So he would have been involved in the very, very early stages of that declaration. But Has it teeth? No, I don't think so.
No, except for the example you give of Ecuador, where since it has such a large indigenous population, it was easier to get the constitution changed so that it included giving rights to nature and it included more of the kind of indigenous perspective that you are thinking about. I don't know whether there, I mean, I had one other question, but I don't know whether there's anybody in the audience wanting, oh, there's, Ergen wanted to.
Hi, this is Ergen Tushul. My question relates really to, I mean, we talked about sort of the global art systems of art, I was thinking about the notion of the ethnographic turn, and it's kind of a word which we didn't mention at all. The ethnographic turn, Hal Foster's critique, I wonder where does it sit within, I mean, is it time to talk about indigeneity turn or something like this? I mean, is there kind of a precedent for that? Or, you know, where do we position these artists who come from indigenous background within the sort of contemporary art circuit, if you like?
I think maybe...
What was the question exactly?
Well, should we be talking about an indigenous turn and how might we be positioning these artists? But I was going to say that maybe, in a way, one of the things we were trying to say was, well, actually, a lot of the artists that Jean's been talking about are not really positioned. They're not in the international art system. And if they are, they're presented as in these discourses around nature, which kind of fits into the stereotypes of the native being associated with nature rather than culture and so on. But on the other hand, you presented a very kind of impressive grouping of activist artists, so that the idea of contemporary activist art is very alive and well in this community, maybe more so than in many others right now, and with really important political issues at stake. So I'm not saying that it shouldn't be discussed in those terms, but I think it would be quite difficult. The problem with the ethnographic turn, or the idea of the artist as the ethnographer, was that artists were working with ethnographic concepts and images, but through a process of othering. They weren't actually often from those positions themselves. They were using their position as artists to make often progressive statements around ethnographic terms.
Well, I mean, with some of the earlier work that I showed here, and yes, it is, you'd call it all artists who use conceptual means. But the earlier work, it was, a lot of it, of the 80s, for example, it was deconstructing or decolonizing the ethnographic. So that was their position on it. But as for white artists doing ethnographic-y kind of things,
I think in the Foster argument, it was more like these are kind of fashion trends. Yeah. And he was sort of criticizing that sort of position as a sort of new criticality, but a criticality that was being co-opted because it was in service of the kind of museum and sort of art world trends, etc. But I think this sort of question of the indigenous turn is a kind of interesting one, because I think it is a kind of rereading the form. But I think one of the other things as well is that in the various, I was thinking about this in the first clip, and I was thinking about the kind of, well, let's say the ghosting of the ethnographic and the way in which there's the desire to deconstruct, let's say from the artist's point of view, but there's always this sort of transitional or sort of contestation that's taking place in terms of framing how it's being viewed. depending on who's looking. So the framing of it, or let's say the kind of visual language, you know, wants to escape the framing. Does it escape the framing? That's, I think, I don't know if that's what you're inferring, but I think,
I mean, it,
but I think it is about, also about who's looking.
Exactly.
I think that's the difference, you know, because, you know, it's the gaze, there's the white gaze or the kind of the gaze, but the question of, you know, who's looking and who it's for, and the intentionality, I think that's what was being challenged when I was making my work, you know, about the gaze and who's looking. Mm. And I think that it was the kind of, the two who I were trying to get me to view from their position, which is a kind of impossibility, right? To a certain degree, you know, it can just be viewed beside, you know. So, but kind of the radicality then and the language doesn't fit into the lingua franca of the cosmopolitan, sophisticated view. Do you see what I mean? There's a tension in the work, which I think is a useful tension, actually. It's not ascribing and fitting neatly, you know, core art in that sense, you know. Mm. Yeah.
It's a very good point. I mean, is it made by the audiences, as you suggested, or is it inherent in the work? I mean, at what point the work is ethnographic or indigenous, and at what point it's how shall I reframe it? So, is it in, you know, at what point does it an indigenous art becomes an indigenous contemporary art? And, you know, is it made by the audiences, or does it have its own sort of premises as such? I mean, I'm thinking about Breton's collection of Northwest American. You know, he had a very, very large collection, and but he never framed that collection as something else. You know, for him, he really kind of remained true to its indigenous properties, if you like. Just interesting proposition. So I was wondering, you know, whether we moved that far from that point. And
that's also a very interesting point, just to look back for a moment, as you say, as to the power of, in quote, primitive art on the development of contemporary art. That is to say, there was that moment in the 1920s and 30s when, okay, people went on these colonial ethnographic expeditions, but they actually then interpreted the work in ways which gave birth to a lot of the tropes of contemporary art. It's not just the fragmentation of the picture plane and in say Picasso coming from African sculpture. It's also in the post-war period the development of performance art through films like Jean Rouch's work with people in Africa, Les Maîtres Fous, that there's this kind of trade or exchange of aesthetics and forms between what we're calling Western contemporary art and these other traditions, shall we call it. Mm. And I think there's another negative sense of the word global, in which we've slightly lost that sense, in which everything is now included in the contemporary art kind of sphere without us really recognizing the different positions from which people are speaking, I would say.
Yeah, and yes, I think we've lost a certain depth, and part of that is actually a historical depth. Mm. I mean, it's, once you start digging into these issues, you find that the influence of one culture on another goes back historically quite deeply, but a lot of it gets repressed. Mm. So, I mean, yeah, I've been working with Palestinian artists, so I've been kind of like digging around in the Middle East. And frankly, you know, like Arab culture has been super influential on European culture. Mm. For a millennium or more, maybe two. And yet it's suddenly there's this like clash of cultures nonsense going around, which completely erases how much we have in the past built on Arab culture and vice versa.
Yeah, there was that scandal in the newspaper last week that the Roman Catholic Church in Spain is trying to register the mosque cathedral in Cordoba as a Christian church. And they've erased all reference to its Arab heritage from their description of the work. And now there's legal attempts to try and get that changed. But apart from the very sensitive political issue around the notion of the Christian crusade and so on, it just shows how live some of those issues still are centuries after. But in a way, I think you've managed to give us that perspective too in this talk, because you've taken us back to the early periods of colonization and genocide in the exploitation of the West, as well as up to date with a number of artists who are working today from these different communities. So I'm sort of taking the opportunity to wind it up now, but if someone's got a pressing question, please do ask if we have time for one more question.
There's a question. Yeah.
I've got the microphone.
Great. Oh, you've just got the microphone. Well,
you just got the microphone, right.
Thank you. I was just, because you were talking earlier about your work, Isaac, and I wondered how does art play into this? I mean, do you feel like it lifts consciousness, or is it trying to kind of pull apart these questions, and or is it all of these things? And what, because it's something that's quite difficult, you know, because there's obviously artists that have activism as their practice, but then there's activism and how it all kind of ties together or not.
Well, I think there has been this activist term, you know, in contemporary art, and I think that's alive and well, and I think sort of there are the examples that Jean was giving, but I think, made this work recently on Capital, but in that work, I didn't really concentrate so much on Occupy, you know, and then of course, when I went to Hong Kong, and I saw how those methodologies were being appropriated, like the Occupy kind of the center of Hong Kong, I thought, wow, you know, in a way sort of like, okay, those kind of methods may have their sort of issues, but it really had grasped and made this sort of intervention in this very kind of mainstream way and had given this sort of language to sort of the young Hong Kong people. And so that was really quite interesting and was questioning my own relationship to how I was viewing it from this, say, you know, well, you could call it sort of European perspective, and how that was being read in an Asian context and then being appropriated in terms of a body politic. So that was very interesting. But I think in my own work, it is, I think the Capital work is a kind of activist work to a certain extent, and it's quite different from the works that I've made. But then I would say that some of my other works, which are more aesthetic, are kind of activist as well. They're hijacking other ways and modes of trying to explore these questions. So I guess I wouldn't prioritize one way over another. But I think we're coming to the end, aren't we?
Yeah, I think, well, I mean, that's another very big topic, because we're in an art school, but of course, the question of activism should be something we take out into our lives as subjects, as, if you like, part members of the society, as well as artists and critics. So I think my only reservation about the discussion with activism is if we see it as happening entirely within the art space, because I think actually there's a place outside and that the way art works is to help free up some of those discourses so you can make more of a political impact. And you can cross boundaries in a way that you couldn't, like Isaac has been doing with his work and a number of the artists that Jean has showed. So, well, yes, thank you very much, everybody. We look forward to Isaac's next talk, which will be announced in due course.
I'd just like to say thank you very much. And I think what's happened here is we've just sort of opened up a tiny little crack here of an enormous subject. And I think as chair of global or planetary art, indigenous art, I think we look forward to Isaac really taking this on, but doing it obviously with us. And I think that what we should perhaps try to do is to gather a community of interest, people who are particularly interested in this theme, to see how we can develop it. Because I think it would be a real shame if the conversation started and sort of more or less fizzled out now. We need to carry this conversation on. Not least, of course, because we are an incredibly international university. I think there are 90 different students from 90 different countries at this university, and it certainly prides itself on being extremely international. So that's one very good reason, nothing else, for trying to progress that conversation. So I'd like to say thank you very much to Isaac, to Jean, and to Mark for a very intriguing start of a conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.